Hey everyone, what's up? It's Rob Dodson, and in today's episode, we're going to be picking up where we left off last time with the core toolbar. We're going to be combining it with our new best friend, the core header panel, to build our very first application. So let's check it out. Now, the core header panel is the first element we've touched upon that's going to give us the beginnings of a full-blown application scaffold. But before we dive into the header panel itself, I want to take a moment to reflect on where we're at this point. Now, so far, we've been learning each element as a single-purpose building block. And the value in doing this is that once you've mastered a few of these building blocks, you can start to assemble them into different structures. You can think of this kind of in the same way that you put together all the bricks that make up a house. In the programming world, this is often referred to as composition. And generally, I like to think of composition as taking one really big thing and assembling it out of a bunch of smaller, single-purpose pieces that are really easy to understand. That's basically what we're going to be doing with the core header panel today, and really just moving forward with web components in general. So as we're working, I want you to keep that idea of composition in the back of your head. I want you to see if you can pick out the places where we're taking simple building blocks and composing them together into these bigger, more complex structures. OK, so let's get started with the header panel. Here's what we're planning to build today. As you can see, we've got the beginnings of a really simple mobile application. Now, the core header panel by itself is really just a scaffold. It's got a header area up at the top, which can hold something like a core toolbar, and it's got a content area down below. One thing to note is that for the header panel to display, both it and its parent are going to need to have an explicit height set. Now, this is a really common pitfall for developers when they first start working with the header panel. They'll drop the tag on the page, but then they won't see anything showing up on their screen, and that's because those heights aren't set. Even if the header panel had a default height in percents, you still wouldn't see anything until you give the parent, which in this case is the body, an explicit height as well. Now you can do this in CSS by setting the HTML and the body to have a height of 100% and then telling the core header panel to have a height of 100% to match. Or you can get a little fancy and you can use layout attributes to do this with Flexbox. And that's how we're going to do it. So we're going to use a layout attribute and a vertical attribute. And these are going to tell the body to lay out its children vertically from top to bottom. And we're also going to tell our header panel that we want it to flex. And that way, it's going to try to fill as much of the screen as it can. And you should also remember the full bleed attribute from our last video. That's going to tell the body tag to remove all of its margin and padding. And that way, our content can go right up to the edges of the screen. Now, to make our toolbar display, we're just going to drop a core toolbar element into our header panel. And the cool thing is, the header panel is smart enough to know that if it has a core toolbar child, it should just place it up here at the top of the screen. And by default, it's actually going to keep it pinned up there. It's actually a sticky toolbar. And I'll show you an example of what that looks like in just a bit. Now, another thing to point out is that you don't have to use a core toolbar here if you don't want to. You could also use a div with a class of core header. That would also get pinned to the top of the screen. Now, for the content inside of our header panel, we're just going to drop a div on the page. And I've just gone ahead and filled it with some markup and some shapes so that we have something to display in our application. Any child that is not a core toolbar element or doesn't have that core header class, it's going to end up displaying in this main content area down here. So you're not limited to just this one div. You could have as many as you want. Generally, I just put one here. That way, I can give the content of my application some consistent padding. Now, the header panel's main job is to control the scrolling behavior on the page. So you'll see that as the user is swiping on their phone, the toolbar stays pinned up at the top of the document, and the content is sliding underneath it. And the thing to note here is that we're not writing any CSS, nor are we writing any JavaScript to make this happen. The header panel is just a smarter primitive that knows what to do when there's a core toolbar inside of it. Now, if we want to change the behavior of our header panel, it's really as simple as changing an attribute. If we give it a mode attribute and set it to scroll, then you'll see that as the user is scrolling the page, the toolbar moves with the rest of the content. Now, there's a few other values that we can use for that mode. But instead of just talking about it, how about we hop into our code editor and actually get some of this showing up on screen? So over in my terminal, I'm going to write bower install save polymer slash core elements. Now, that's actually going to go out and fetch all the elements in the core set. And the reason I'm doing this is because when I'm developing a site or an application, it's just a lot easier to install everything in the set. And that way, I don't have to keep switching back and forth between my project and the terminal just to install a few more elements. Also, the only elements that are actually served in my application are the ones that I've written HTML imports for. So if you're OK with having all the elements on your local disk, this can be a really convenient way to develop. Switching to our code editor, we've already laid out a basic application using the code from the previous slides. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create a file to hold all the imports that I'm going to use in my application. So I'll pop up in my sidebar, and I'll create a new file called elements.html. Now, I'm just going to paste in all the imports that I'm going to use in this project. And really quickly, what I've got here is I've got core header panel, core toolbar, core icon buttons, and core icons.html. And that's going to load in the definition for the core icon element as well as the default icon set. So save this, and back in my index.html file, I'm going to create an import to load in that elements.html file that I just created. Now, this is going to do two things. It's going to keep the head tag in my index.html file nice and tidy. It's also going to make it much easier to vulcanize all of my imports together when it's time to ship this into production. Now, taking a look down at the code, you'll see that it's basically the same thing that we had in the slides. We've got full bleed attribute and a few of the other layout attributes like layout and vertical. We've got our core header panel inside of here, and inside of that, we've got our core toolbar. One thing to note is that down in my content div, if I pop this open, you'll see that there's a whole bunch of markup inside of here. This is just boilerplate that I've created so we can lay out a bunch of shapes on screen to give our app some content. You don't actually need to worry about any of the code that's inside of this element. It's really just for presentation. Now, back in our terminal, I'm going to start up a local server so we can preview the application. I'm going to do python-m simple HTTP server and run it on port 9000. You can use any local server that you want. I'm just using Python because it comes pre-installed on Macs, but if you want to start a Node server or an Apache server, all that will work just fine. Now, hopping back into Chrome, if we open up a page at localhost 9000, this is what we should see. We've got our toolbar up at the top, and all of our content is scrolling underneath it. So right now, the layout is really designed for a mobile device. It's not so great on our desktop. If we want to actually preview this on our phone, we can open up the hamburger menu and go down to More Tools, Inspect Devices, and that's going to pop up this window right here. And I'm actually just going to zoom in a little bit so you can see what's happening. It's going to ask us if we want to forward one of our ports. I've already got localhost 9000 set up here because that's the place where we're running our local server. So put in localhost 9000, go down and click Done. And then over in this little box, we can just type in the URL that we'd like Chrome to open. So I'll type in http://localhost9000. And if I've got Chrome running on my device, I can click Open. And now you can see that we've actually got the application running here on our phone. And it looks really nice. All right, so this is looking really great on my phone. And you know, more importantly, this is just a really useful debugging technique to know about. So if you're interested in learning more about remote debugging, follow the link at the bottom of the screen. Now let's dive back into our code editor, and we'll finish up our application. Now switching back to our site, I'm going to pop open the DevTools, and I'm going to boost the page up a little bit so it's easier to see what we're doing. And over here in our DevTools, I'm going to select the core header panel in the Elements tab. And if you recall, I mentioned before that there are various modes that we can put the header panel into. So to demonstrate this, I'm going to add an attribute here, and I'm going to give it a mode of scroll. And now our toolbar is actually going to scroll with the rest of the content of the page. But there's a few other modes that we can place the toolbar into. If we want, we can place it into a seamed mode. What that's going to do is it's going to keep the toolbar sticky, but you'll see that there's no longer a drop shadow as our content is scrolling underneath it. Another variation on this is if we change the mode to waterfall, the toolbar will start off in a seamed mode, but as we scroll, you'll see that there's now a drop shadow that appears underneath the toolbar and above the rest of the content. And there's one more mode that's actually pretty interesting. If we change it from waterfall to waterfall-tall, now pay attention to what happens here, the toolbar itself gets a lot bigger. And if you inspect the core toolbar element, you'll see that it now has these two classes, animate and tall. Basically, the header panel has reached in, and it has told the toolbar that it should have these additional classes. Now, if you remember from the last episode, we can add classes to the children of a core toolbar to pin them to different locations. So if I open up my core header panel, find the title div inside of my toolbar, then I can actually give it some classes here. I'm going to give it a bottom and indent class. And you'll see now that the title of my application has kind of jumped to the bottom of the toolbar. It's sort of indented over, so it's moved out of the way of our hamburger menu up here in the top left. And what's going to happen is, as we scroll the page, you'll see that the toolbar collapses, and the title of our application moves with it. Now, this is a pretty wild effect, which you get basically for free by adding an attribute and setting a few classes on your toolbar. I think it's pretty neat. All right, there's one more mode for the header panel that I want to show you, but we're going to need to hop back into our code editor to look at it. So back in our code editor, we're going to set one final mode on the header panel. We're going to change its mode to cover. And the cover mode is going to take this content div, and it's actually going to float it visibly on top of the core toolbar. So to do this, we're going to open up our app CSS file, and I'm just going to drop in some CSS that I've already got saved here, and I'll walk you through what's going on. So we're selecting the core header panel, and then we're using this shadow pseudo element to target its main container child. Now, the main container child is where the content of our page is actually being projected. So we're telling the content of the page to move over from the left edge of the screen by 180 pixels. Then we're selecting the content element, and we're telling it that we want it to have a right margin of 180 pixels. Now, I know that this makes absolutely no sense until you see what I'm doing in the screen, so let's hop back over to Chrome. You'll see here that we've now got a page with our content with kind of like a medium gray background behind it. And as we're scrolling the page, the content is actually visibly floating above the toolbar. And on either side, we've got 180 pixels of space. So it's a pretty interesting visual effect, and now you know how to pull it off in your own app. So in this video, we've covered a lot of really interesting stuff. We've started down the path of composition by taking the header panel and combining it with the core toolbar and the icon button and the icons. We've got an application that looks really great on our phone. It looks a little iffy on our desktop. And so in the next video, I'm going to show you one more element that you can combine with the core header panel to make an experience that's both gorgeous on your desktop as well as your mobile device. So thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.